Hi students, I welcome you to this class. Here we'll study a lesson in English for students of class 10th. This is a poem titled Ozymandias, written by P.B. Shelley, and I am your tutor Ruchika Gupta. Here let us see what we'll cover. We'll cover the explanation of the poem and the literary devices used in this poem. If you want to see the background and summary of this poem Ozymandias, it is given in a separate video and the link is given in the description box. So let us begin with this lesson. So the poem begins like this. I met a traveller from an antique land who said, two vast and trunkless legs of stone stand in the desert. Near them, on the sand, half sunk, a shattered visage lies. First of all, we'll see the meanings. The word I here stands for the poet. The poet is saying that he met a traveller from an antique land. What is antique? Antique means an old land. The next word is trunkless. Trunkless means without the upper part of the body. So the upper part of the body is missing. Next word is sunk. Sunk means drowned. And the next word is shattered. Shattered means broken. Then visage. Visage means the face. So in this stanza, the poet says that he met a traveller from an old land. And this traveller told the poet that he saw two vast and trunkless legs. That means he saw two legs without the upper part of the body. And they were made of stone. So that was a part of a statue. The remains of a statue. They were standing in the desert. So where did he see these two legs? In the desert. And then he says near them, near these two legs, on the sand, half sunk, a shattered visage lies. So he saw that nearby there was a broken face of the same statue that was lying in the desert. So in this stanza, the poet tells us that he met a traveller who had been to an antique land. And this antique land is Egypt. The country called Egypt. And this traveller told the poet that in Egypt, in the desert, he saw the remains of a statue. And what were the remains that he saw? He saw two legs. They were standing in the desert and the upper portion of the body was missing. Nearby these legs, there were the broken remains of the face of the statue and they were half sunk in the sand. That means they were buried partially in the sand of the desert. Now we move ahead. Whose frown and wrinkled lip and sneer of cold command tell that its sculptor well those passions read, which yet survive, stamped on these lifeless things, the hand that mocked them and the heart that fed. Let us see the meanings. Frown means an expression of anger. The next word is sneer. Sneer means to look down upon someone, to feel very proud of yourself and to look down upon others. The next word is cold. Cold here stands for lacking expressions and feelings for others. Being feelingless. The next word is command. Command means domination. Having an upper hand, having dominating qualities. The next word is passions. Passions here refers to the expressions on the face of the king Ozymandias. The next word is stamped. Stamped here means engraved on the statue. Next word is mocked. Mocked means to copy something. So in this stanza, what is the poet saying? He says that the face that is half sunk in the sand has an expression of frown and the lips are wrinkled, which show a sneering expression of being very cold, emotionless and dominating. So these are the expressions that are there on the face of the statue that is lying in the sand. And this statue is the statue of King Ozymandias. So the poet is saying that the sculptor was very fine. he read the expressions on the face of King Ozymandias very well, and he copied them very nicely onto the statue. And then he says, the hand that mocked them and the heart that fed. So he says that the hand that mocked them refers to the hand of the sculptor, which copied the expressions onto the statue. The heart that fed refers to the heart of King Ozymandias, which produced these expressions. So in this stanza, the poet is saying that the sculptor who has made this statue was a very fine person because he was very good at his work. He analyzed the expressions on the king's face very well and he copied them onto the statue perfectly. So he says that the statue has these expressions of anger, and his wrinkled lip shows a sneering quality of being emotionless and dominating, which were there in the King Ozymandias. And then he says that the sculptor had analyzed these expressions on the king's face very well, and he was very good at his work of making the statue, and he copied them exactly onto the statue. Then he says, the hand that mocked them, he refers to the sculptor who copied these expressions onto the statue. The heart that fed refers to the King Ozymandias, who produced these expressions and who had these expressions on his face. Now we move ahead. Then he says, and on the pedestal, these words appear. My name is Ozymandias, King of Kings. Look upon my works, ye mighty, and despair. Here the word pedestal means the base of the statue, a platform. And the next word is ye. Ye means you. This is an old-fashioned, archaic word which is no longer used in English. It stands for you. Mighty here refers to the powerful kings. So King Ozymandias is referring to the powerful kings of the world. Despair means at a complete loss of hope, being dejected, being hopeless. So this is the engraving on the platform of this statue. And what are the words written over here? The words read, my name is Ozymandias, King of Kings. So Ozymandias is introducing himself as being a King of Kings, being very powerful, very mighty. And he tells to all the powerful kings of the world that, look upon my works. So what are the works that he is talking about? The huge statue that he has got erected of himself. Whereas that statue does not exist any longer. So this is the irony that the poet is saying. The poet is saying that the engraving on this platform says, look upon my works, ye mighty, and despair. But on the other hand, there is no work over there. The platform is just lying bare in the sand and the statue is nowhere to be seen. It has been destroyed with the passage of time. And he says that you, all you powerful kings of the world, you will look upon my mighty, my great statue and feel sad and hopeless. So this shows us how proud King Ozymandias was that he has got such a huge statue of his erected. He has written on the pedestal that I am Ozymandias, the King of Kings. And then he addressed all the powerful kings of the world and told them to look at his work, look at his accomplishment of getting such a huge statue erected, and feel sad and despair. Now we move ahead to the next set of lines. Nothing beside remains. Round the decay of the colossal wreck, boundless and bare, the lone and level sands stretch far away. Now here the word colossal means extremely large or great. Wreck means ruin. The remains. Boundless means without any limits, having no limits. Bare means without the statue of King Ozymandias. So the word bare here means that the statue of King Ozymandias is not present there. Lone means the only survivor. So in these lines, the poet is saying that just the platform remains there. nothing besides remains means there is no other trace of the statue other than this platform which has the engraving on it. So the huge statue which King Ozymandias had erected does not exist any longer. Then he says round the decay, round the remains of that huge great ruin, boundless and bare. Boundless and bare means without any limits and without the statue of King Ozymandias. What is the only thing that is visible? The only survivor is the huge stretch of sand, the huge stretch of the desert. So here the poet is saying that today, other than the platform which has that engraving on it, nothing else of the statue remains. The statue has been completely destroyed. And then he says that around the remains of that huge statue, there is the boundless, that is, there is a huge desert which has no limits, and the desert is without the statue of King Ozymandias. So the only thing that is visible around is the huge stretch of sand in that desert. So now we have read the poem. Now let us see the literary devices used in this poem. The first device is synecdoche dosh, which is a figure of speech in which a part is made to represent the whole. When the poet says the hand that mocked them, he is referring to the sculptor. So the hand over here refers to the sculptor. So by talking of one part of the sculptor's body, his hand, the poet is referring to the sculptor. And then when he says the heart that fed, the heart refers to King Ozymandias. So again, when he is referring to the heart, he is referring to a part of his body, but he wants to indicate King Ozymandias. So this is synecdoche dosh. The next device used is hyperbole, that is exaggeration. When he says King of Kings, this is exaggeration. Another literary device used is irony. Irony means creating mockery of something. When he says, look upon my works, ye mighty and despair, nothing beside remains. So the poet is saying, on one hand, the king is saying that, look upon my great works, you powerful kings of the world, and feel sad and hopeless. But there is nothing to look upon at. This is an irony. Let us see some more devices used in this poem. There is alliteration also, that is the repetition of a consonant sound in consecutive or nearby words. When he says too vast and trunkless, here the ter sound has been repeated. Cold command, here cur sound has been repeated. The hand that mocked them and the heart that fed. Here the sound has been repeated in 3-4 instances. Next, boundless and bare. Bur sound is being repeated. Lone and level. Here, ler sound is being repeated. Sans stretch. Sir sound is being repeated. Another device used is oxymoron. Oxymoron is the apparent use of contradictory terms in conjunction. Means in close connection. When he says colossal wreck. Colossal means very great. And wreck means something which has been destroyed and finished. So these two words are apparently contradictory. And this is the use of the device called oxymoron. So with this, we have seen the explanation of the poem and the literary devices used in it. Thank you.